my honor and privilege to introduce the first speaker of this Magna Conference that celebrates the 100 years of the Brazilian Academy of Science. Dr. Takaaki Kajita is recipient of the 2015 Nobel Prize in Physics. This highest recognition was given for his work explaining neutrino oscillations and proving that neutrinos have mass, a result that challenged the then established standard model of particle physics. He has been awarded several other prizes, among them the Bruno Rossi Prize, the Panofsky Prize, the Asahi Prize, the Nishima Memorial Prize, the Julius Vest Award, and more recently, the Breakthrough Prize in Fundamental Physics. Dr. Kajita was born in 1959, and in 1999 became director of the Center for Cosmic Neutrinos at the Institute for Cosmic Ray Research. Since last year, Dr. Kajita is the director of the Institute of Cosmic Ray Research and a member of the Kavli Institute for Physics and Mathematics of the Universe at the University of Tokyo. His work follows a distinguished lineage. His doctoral advisor was Professor Masatoshi Koshiba, also from the University of Tokyo, and who was awarded the 2002 Nobel Prize in Physics for his contributions to neutrino astrophysics. The success story that spans more than 30 years shows the importance of long-term support and funding of quality research. It has been said that deep understanding of neutrino complexities can change our understanding of the history, structure, and fate of the universe. With this thought, I will leave you with the 2015 Physics Nobel Prize, Dr. Takaaki Kajita.
Good morning. Well, first of all, I want to thank the Brazilian Academy of Sciences for the kind invitation. Also, I want to congratulate the Brazilian Academy of Sciences for the 100 years of anniversary. Now, I want to discuss neutrino oscillation experiments, past, present, and future. By the way, in fact, I prefer to see my slide here. Okay. The outline of this talk is summarized here. I have a brief introduction on neutrinos. Before describing, I want to say, although the title of this talk is general, but I'm going to discuss, more on experiment at Kamioka. So now, in the second part, I want to discuss the hint for oscillations, that is the atmospheric neutrino deficit. Next, discovery of neutrino oscillations. Present status of neutrino oscillations, future directions. And before concluding, I want to mention about the researches in Kamioka, and I will summarize. Okay, what are neutrinos? This is going to be very short. Well, neutrinos are fundamental particles like electrons and quarks. They have no electric charge. They have three types or flavors, namely electron neutrinos, muon neutrinos, and tau neutrinos. And they are produced in various places, such as the Earth's atmosphere, or the center of the sun, or many other places. And they can easily penetrate through the earth or even the sun. Well, of course, if they do not interact at all, then we have no way to study neutrinos. Fortunately, they can interact with matter very rarely. And if a neutrino interaction occurs, then a muon neutrino produces a muon. Electron neutrinos produces an electron. And that way, we can identify the neutrino flavor. And I want to mention that in the very successful standard model of particle physics, neutrinos are assumed to have no mass. However, we physicists have been asking, neutrinos really have no mass. Oh, sorry. Now, atomic neutrino deficit. Well, from now on, actually, I'm going to describe the old history related to Kamiokande. Therefore, I want to describe the motivation first. Well, as you may know, in the 70s, new theories that unify strong, weak, and electromagnetic forces were proposed. And these theories predicted that protons and neutrons, namely nucleons, should decay with the lifetime of about 10 to 28 to 10 to 32 years. This is a very long lifetime, but this can be measured. This can be measured. Therefore, several proton decay experiments began in the early 80s, and one of them was the Kamiokande experiment. It was a 3-kiloton water Cherenkov detector. The photo is shown in the left. The principle of the experiment is shown here. If a particle, a charged particle, is generated in water, while they travel in water, the photon called Cherenkov photon is produced. And these photons are detected by photomultiplier tubes instrumented at the surface of the detector. And by the detailed studies of the Cherenkov photon pattern and the light intensity, we get the information on the charged particle. Well, what is the experiment? The Kamiokande experiment is located in Hida Prefecture, which is shown here, and in the Gifu Prefecture and Hida City. Hida City is here, and the site is something like this in the winter, and the more specifically, the experiment is located in a very small village, shown here. Now, well, of course, we had to construct the detector. And this is the photo we took in the spring of 1983. Well, essentially, these are the people who constructed the Kamiokande detector. And you can see in the middle, Professor Koshiba, who was the Nobel Prize laureate in 2002. And well, actually, well, in front, there are professors, and two, three meters behind, there are graduate course students. And one of them was me. Well, okay, this detector was constructed in the active mine. Therefore, in order to construct the detector, we had to use the mine, old little mine train. This is the real photo. Then, after 3 kilometers of travel with this train, essentially we arrived at the construction site. And this is the photo we took while constructing the Kamiokande detector. Well, the size of the Kamiokande was about 16 meters in diameter and 16 meters in height. And we have to install the photo tubes at the bottom side and the top. And well, 16 meter height is really high. Therefore, we had to be careful. And in the end, we decided to use rubber boards to install photomultiplier tubes. And I think this was me. Now, I want to discuss atmospheric neutrinos. Well, you know, cosmic ray particles enter into the atmosphere. Then they interact with the air nucleus. And typically, with these interactions, pions are produced. Then these pions decay to muon, then to electron. And during this decay chain, one electron neutrino and 2 muon neutrinos are produced. And we observe these neutrinos in underground. As I said, Kamiokande was a proton decay experiment. Therefore, we wanted to understand the atmospheric neutrino interactions, which are background to the proton decay, such as. During these studies, it was found that there was a significant deficit of atmospheric muon neutrino events. And this is, well, this is the summary of the paper we published in 1988. Well, if we look at the number of events observed in Kamiokande for electron neutrinos, comparing with the theoretically, well, Monte Carlo simulation, then there was a fair good agreement. However, if we compare the muon neutrinos between data and Monte Carlo simulation, there was a clear deficit. And therefore, well, actually, in order to come to this conclusion, we had to work seriously more than 1 year. And well, in this paper, we concluded that we are unable to explain the data as the result of systematic detector effects or uncertainties in the atmospheric neutrino fluxes, some as yet unaccounted for physics, such as neutrino oscillations might explain the data. Okay, that was the conclusion. But, well, of course, you have to know what are neutrino oscillations. Unfortunately, I cannot go into detail, but I just want to show the theoretical prediction. That is, if neutrinos have masses, neutrinos change their flavor from one flavor to the other. For example, oscillations could occur between muon neutrinos and tau neutrinos. And this figure shows the oscillation probability from muon neutrinos to, oscillation probability that muon neutrinos remain to muon neutrinos, assuming muon neutrino to tau neutrino oscillations. The blue curve shows the new mu to the probability of new mu to remain new mu. So after some distances, the probability gets minimum, but if they travel further, the probability comes to unity, but if they travel further, the probability gets lower again. And when the probability of muon neutrino remain to muon neutrino gets minimum, the probability of muon neutrino to tau neutrino get the maximum. So this is the neutrino oscillations. And well, I want to mention these are the main people who theoretically predicted neutrino oscillations. And also I want to mention the distance between the production point to the, for example, to the first minimum point is very important, because if neutrino mass is smaller, the oscillation length gets larger. Therefore, by observing, for example, this dip, you can know you can get the information on the neutrino masses. Now, well, when Kamiokande published the first new mu deficit in 1988, there was no support for a while. But after 3 years, the IMB experiment, that was another large water Cherenkov detector, also reported the deficit of new mu events. So it is very good that at least two experiments observed the deficit. However, we thought that simply the deficit of mu neutrinos is not really enough to conclude neutrino oscillations. We thought that we need much stronger evidence for oscillations. Then, what will be the next? Well, for some neutrino masses, the neutrinos created in the upper atmosphere traveling to the detector travels only a small distances, 10, 20 kilometers. Therefore, they may have not enough time to oscillate. So muon neutrinos created can arrive to the detector with muon neutrinos. However, neutrinos produced in the other side of the Earth travels long distances, typically 10,000 kilometers, before arriving to the detector. So they may have enough time to oscillate. Therefore, one could possibly observe the significant up-down asymmetry. And this up-down asymmetry can be really strong evidence for oscillations. However, in order to observe this effect, Kamiokande was not big enough. Therefore, we needed much larger detector. That was Super Kamiokande. Now, I want to describe the discovery of neutrino oscillations. Well, Super Kamiokande is a much larger version of the Kamiokande detector. It is a 50 kiloton water Cherenkov detector. And in fact, Super Kamiokande is an international collaboration of about 120 collaborators from several countries. And this detector is, of course, a big detector. Therefore, in order to construct the Super Kamiokande detector, we needed much larger number of people to construct the detector compared with the Kamiokande construction. And in fact, this photo, taken in the spring of 1995, it is clear that really a lot of people worked for the construction. And I can say that maybe well, among these people, about 80 to 90% of them are physicists and graduate course students. So really, we worked hard in order to construct the Super Kamiokande detector. And well, after almost 1 year of hard work, the Super Kamiokande detector was essentially ready to take data. This photo was taken in January 1996, when we started to put the pure water in the detector. And in fact, the Super Kamiokande detector worked quite well from the beginning. This is a typical photo we observed in Super Kamiokande. This is a typical muon neutrino event observed in Super K, and this is a typical multi-Cherenkov ring event. We have even more. This is a typical partially contained event, where neutrino interaction occur in the inner detector, but at least one charged particle, typically a muon, penetrate to the outer detector. And you can see the outer detector signal here. And finally, this is a typical upward going muon event, where muon neutrino interaction occurs below the detector, and only a muon is observed from the bottom to the top. And in this event, a muon enters from this point and exits to this point. So all these types of events are used in the analysis. Therefore, it was essential that the collaborative work of many people, especially, I want to say, collaborative work of many young people was essential. So, since the detector worked quite well, we didn't need much time to come to the to get the first important result. And the first result was presented in Neutrino 98 conference. And this is one of the slides we presented at the conference. This is the Jin-Sang distribution, where one means neutrinos coming from above. Minus one means neutrinos coming from the other side of the Earth. And this is for electron neutrino event, and this is for muon neutrino event. And in particular, you can see and there is a deficit, very large deficit of muon neutrino events coming from the other side of the Earth. And in fact, if we take the up-down asymmetry of the data, it was already more than six sigma effect. So with this, Super Kamiokande concluded that the observed Jin-Sang dependent deficit and the other Super Kamiokande concluded that the observed Jin-Sang dependent deficit and the other supporting data gave evidence for neutrino oscillations. And I want to say that fortunately, there were other atmospheric neutrino experiments at that time. And these experiments also observe the same effect. One experiment was Makro in Gran Sasso. They observed the upward going muons. And here is the horizontal going, and here is upward going. And the observed Jin-Sang dependence was not explained if you do not assume neutrino oscillations. Another experiment was the Sudan II experiment in United States, and they observed the deficit of upward going events. So these experiments observed atomic neutrinos and confirmed neutrino oscillations, and therefore oscillation was very quickly accepted by the community. Now, I want to move on to the present status of neutrino oscillations. Well, this was the zenith angle distribution from Super Kamiokande in 1998. At that time, we had 531 events in order to make this plot. Now, if we do the same selection criteria, the zenith angle distribution is something like this, and we have now more than 5,000 events. So the data statistics was improved by more than a factor of 10 compared with the statistics in 98. So we have been doing various studies of neutrino oscillations with these high statistics data. Just an example, I want to show you how much improvement we achieved with these recent high statistics data. This is the published neutrino oscillation allowed parameter region in 98. So, this was the 90% confidence level allowed region from Super Kamiokande. Now, if we expand this region and plot the the oscillation result in 2012, then the allowed region is this small. So you can see that we had really a big improvement in the understanding of neutrino oscillation parameters. For example, I want to tell you vertical axis is delta M square, which is related to the neutrino mass, and the data suggest that the heaviest neutrino mass is approximately 10 million times smaller than the electron mass. Also, the horizontal axis is sine square 2 theta, that is the mixing angle. And the data suggest that new mu's oscillate maximally to taus, new taus. And in my opinion, this was really a surprising result. Now, because of this discovery, there have been a lot of accelerator-based long baseline experiments to study the details of oscillations. And, well, basically, these are the experiments that contributed to neutrino oscillation studies in the oscillation mode of new mu to new tau. And I want to show you some examples. This is the history of the observed muon neutrino spectrum after the long distances. This is the first long baseline experiment K2K, and they observed the deficit, and this deficit was just consistent with the oscillations. The second one was Minos, and they had much higher statistics, and observed data was very good in agreement with the oscillation prediction. Now, this is the most recent one, T2K experiment. Nowadays, even the unoscillated expectation is plotted because now the most important check is how deep the oscillation minimum is. So, the experimental understanding of neutrino oscillations between nu mu to nu tau is progressing as the experiments move on to the newer generations. Another highlight is the tau neutrino appearance by nu mu to nu tau oscillations. And one of the experiments was OPERA. This is a dedicated experiment to observe nu tau oscillations. And this is one example of nu tau production. You can see the tau neutrinos interactions producing tau and decay to other particles. So far, they have observed 5 tau neutrino events with the background of 0.25, which is already more than 5 sigma effect. And Super Kamiokande is also trying to see the new tau production effect. Unfortunately, Super Kamiokande is unable to observe tau event by event basis. Therefore, they do a statistical analysis, and they found that by fitting the Jin-Sang distribution of tau-like events, this is the best fit tau signal, and already the zero tau appearance is disfavored at 3.8 sigma level. So these two experiments are just consistent, and all these experiments told us that the data are just consistent with nu mu to nu tau oscillations. Now, I want to briefly describe the solar neutrino oscillations. As you know, pioneering experiment, that is the homestake solar neutrino experiment, observed only about 1/3 of the predicted solar neutrinos. This was a so-called solar neutrino problem, and we knew this problem since the late 60s. And this problem was confirmed by the subsequent experiments in the 80s and 90s. Now, in this century, the solar neutrino problem was beautifully understood to be due to neutrino oscillations. And the key player in this study was the SNOW experiment. It is a 1 kiloton heavy water Cherenkov experiment. In heavy water, you can observe electron neutrino flux only and the total flux independently. Then the main result from SNOW is summarized here. This is the total flux observed, and this is electron neutrino flux, and you can see electron neutrino flux is essentially 1/3 of the prediction. Since Sun can only produce electron neutrinos, this is the evidence for neutrino oscillations. And due to this, by the way, I want to mention the role of Super Kamiokande. Super Kamiokande uses neutrino electron scattering, and Super Kamiokande is weakly sensitive to nu mu to nu tau. Therefore, the possible discrepancy between SNOW electron neutrino flux measurement and Super K measurement is also indication of nu mu to nu tau flux. So, due to this work in SNOW, Art McDonald also got the Nobel Prize last year. Now, related to solar neutrino oscillation, I want to mention another very important experiment, that is the Kamiland experiment in Kamioka. It is a long baseline experiment observing neutrinos produced by nuclear power stations. I'm sorry. And this is the Kamran. Well, I want to mention Kamran, and it is a long baseline reactor neutrino experiment. And very importantly, this is the survival probability distribution as a function of L over E, and you can see the oscillatory pattern, which is really just predicted by neutrino oscillations. So this experiment really told us that solar neutrino deficit was really due to neutrino oscillations. Now, since there are three neutrino flavors, there should be another type of oscillations based on the third mixing angle. Therefore, the neutrino community has been searching for the third neutrino oscillation effect. And this effect was, in fact, observed recently by the series of reactor neutrino experiments and long baseline experiments. Now, the third mixing angle is, in fact, very precisely determined. Okay, well, so far, I have just described the experimental results. But, of course, you may ask, why? Well, why are neutrinos important? Well, I want to convince you that the measurement of the or discovery of neutrino mass is important with this figure. Well, this figure shows the masses of elementary particles. This is the mass of electron muon tau, and the blue and green colors show the masses of quarks. Now, in this plot, I want to overlay the observed neutrino mass with some assumptions. That is here. So, here. So, you notice that the neutrino masses are very, very, very small compared with the other particles' masses. And, well, in fact, we think that the well, first of all, from this, the neutrino mass is approximately or more than 10 billion or 10 orders of magnitude smaller than the corresponding masses of quarks and charged leptons. And we believe that this is the key to understand the nature of the smallest and the largest scales. That is, the elementary particles and the universe. Okay, well, so far I have been discussing the neutrino oscillation results. Now, finally, I want to describe briefly about the future directions. Well, I showed you this slide. However, I said, with some assumptions. In fact, there's a possibility that the third generation mass, neutrino mass, is smallest. This is, in fact, really a possibility. So we have to study if the third generation neutrino mass is really the heaviest or lightest. Well, you may wonder why we have to study this. Well, so far, the oscillation studies told us that the neutrino parameters are really unexpected. So there may be another unexpected result in the actual measurement of the neutrino mass. So we have to study this effect. I'm unable to go into detail, but there are several experiments that want to study the neutrino mass order. These are the experiments trying to measure the neutrino mass orders. Now, finally, I want to mention another thing that neutrino physics may be relevant. Well, this is a photo of the universe, very far away universe. And we know that, well, all these galaxies are made of matter. There's no antimatter. But if we think about the Big Bang universe, it's strange. Because in Big Bang, with the extremely high temperature, there must be creation of particles and antiparticles in the equal rate. So in the early universe, there must be equal number of particles and the antiparticles. But now we see only particles in our universe. So what is the problem? Well, how we should understand? Well, I think we actually understand fairly well. In the Big Bang universe, there were, say, for example, this number of protons, that is particles, and this number of antiprotons, that is antiparticles. They were almost equal. But and while cooling down to the present universe, most of these particles and antiparticles annihilate, and then only one particle remained. That is the explanation. However, well, of course, we do not know what is the reason for this extra one. And we think that neutrinos with very small masses might be the key to understand the big mystery of this matter in the universe. So we think that with neutrino physics, we might be able to understand this small number here. So how shall we understand this mystery? This mystery needs to be understood based on neutrino oscillation experiments. In more detail, we would like to observe if neutrino oscillations of neutrinos and those of antineutrinos are different. And this is, in fact, a difficult experiment. And we need the next generation long baseline experiments with much higher performance neutrino detectors. So, in fact, there are two projects under serious discussion. That is the LBNF DUNE experiment from Fermilab to the Homestake mine. Another possibility is the JPAC to Kamioka. Now, I want to mention as an example of the future detector, the Hyper-Kamiokande. Hyper-Kamiokande, we have two detectors with, 190 kiloton each, and will be realized with staging. And in fact, in my opinion, even with one detector, the performance will be very high. It will have much better phototubes already developed, and it will be an international collaboration. And at present, there are 250 people. people from 12 countries, including Brazil. Now, in the last 5 minutes or so, I want to discuss the researches in Kamioka. Well, in 1983, we had only one experiment, that was the Kamiokande experiment. In this year, the map of underground Kamioka is shown here. We have Super Kamiokande, Kamran, X-Mass Dark Matter experiment, and several smaller scale R&Ds and so on. In addition, we have Kagura, which is a 3 kilometer by 3 kilometer interferometer for the gravitational wave. Probably this development is due to the dynamics of the science. Also, the Japanese system to ask selected research institutions to host mid to large scale researches, research infrastructures, helps this development in Kamioka. Namely, our institute is hosting most of these experiments. The important exception is the Kamran experiment. Now, in a different way, I want to see the development. And the first experiment was Kamiokande. This was actually not officially recognized as a major scientific project. Therefore, the operations budget, also the construction budget, was based on several competitive grants in aid for scientific researches. But it had major results, such as the detection of supernova neutrinos, confirmation of solar neutrino deficit. And these results convinced the community and the government to move on to the next generation experiment, and that is the Super Kamiokande experiment. And this was recognized as a major scientific project of the order of $100 million and has been supported directly from the Japanese government. And from the beginning, we requested a very long-term support in order to detect the next supernova neutrino burst. Well, in fact, the long-term support was very, very important for the researches in Super K in general. And strong support from the world community were also very important for the approval of the project and also for the recovery from a very serious accident in 2001. And I described the major result in this talk. In addition, I want to mention about Kamran. Well, first of all, Kamran had a great idea to observe reactor neutrinos from long distances. And in addition, at that time, Kamiokande's underground cavity was available. So with some little extension of the cavity, the Kamran was constructed. And also, this experiment was directly supported from the Japanese government, and they had also major discoveries, such as the reactor neutrino oscillations, geoneutrinos, and so on. So, at least from the Super Kamiokande site, we think we had good result, therefore we would like to move on further. That is what I described. Okay, let me summarize. Unexpected muon neutrino deficit in the atmospheric neutrino flux was observed in Kamiokande. Subsequently, in 1998, Super Kamiokande observed neutrino oscillations, which shows that neutrinos have masses. Since then, various experiments have been revealed the nature of neutrinos, and the discovery of non-zero neutrino masses open a window to study physics beyond the standard model of elementary particle physics. Probably, neutrino masses are related to that of the physics of the grand unification of elementary particle interactions. And finally, the researches in Kamioka have been supported strongly by the community and by the Japanese government, and the long-term support was one of the key to get these important results. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thanks very much, Dr. Kajit, for this very enlightening talk on this intriguing particle, the neutrinos. We have time for maybe one, maybe a couple of questions from the audience. Dr. Kajit is willing to answer them. So any first, go ahead. You need the microphone, the second row, right side.
I noticed that the cartoon for Hyper-K has two detection vessels. You said you can get good results with only one. Is there some specific experimental reason for having two closely separated ones?
Well, okay. First of all, you want to be as big as possible. However, due to the limitation of the rock strengths, we decided to construct two detector. Yeah, right.
Um pouco atrás, microfone duas para trás.
It's more a comment than a question. Actually, I would just like to mention that we have a neutrino experiment running in Brazil in a nuclear plant close to Rio. So the aim here is to detect a very low energy neutrinos with coherent oscillations.
Oh, I see. Oh, that's very important. Thank you. I didn't know.
Thank you.
Please, there's a short question, so go ahead. There's a question here on the left side.
Hi. Sorry. Good morning. Over here. Could you say, please, a few words about the current status of Hyper-K?
Okay. Thank you very much. Well, this is a big project. Therefore, we have to be recognized and also evaluated highly by the Japanese community and by the Japanese government. And in every 3 years, there is a cycle of evaluation. And the next one, the result will be presented. Well, the next result will be presented in 2017, next year. Therefore, well, the scientific evaluation is made by the Japanese Council of Japan, and the well, of course, the say government evaluation follows, and therefore we have just submitted our proposal to the Science Council of Japan, and in a year we'll know the evaluation result. That is the status, and of course it is going to be an expensive experiment, therefore we don't know when it will be realized.
The expensive means around $500 million. 500 milhões de dólares, $500 million. That's the lowest. They're trying to bring down to that.
Hello, good morning. How the Antarctic experiments, such as the ice cube, are helping the understanding of the neutrino?
Okay, and the ice cube experiment is essentially for experiments trying, it's an experiment trying to observe ultra high energy astrophysical neutrinos. And therefore, as far as the neutrino oscillation study is concerned, And the present generation of Ice Cube is not powerful. However, they have a plan to implement a very high density array in the middle of the Ice Cube array. And with that, they would like to get the answer to the neutrino mass pattern problem.
Good morning. Thank you for an enlightening talk. I'm a geologist and I visited the Homestake mine. I understand, I've not been to Kamioka, but I understand that in Homestake mine, you have some radioactive black shales. Radioactive black shales on the rocks in Homestake. I'm asking you, what is the rock type or types in Kamiokande and whether it has an interference?
Okay, well,
your experiments.
Thank you. Actually, I don't know the name of the rock in English. But anyway, this is a kind of standard rock. And in fact, it contains a lot of radioactivity, such as uranium and thorium. But all these radioactivities are shielded by the detector configuration. Because we have the outer detector layer, and with this outer detector layer, most of the radioactivities are absorbed.
Any other question? One more, and then the last one.
At the end of your talk, you mentioned, you alluded to CP violation, I think, in the neutrino sector.
Yeah.
And basically, you have to measure a phase in the neutrino mass matrix to get this done.
Yes.
This is incredibly difficult, as you said. How difficult? I mean, is there anything on the books that will, in fact, get us there? Of course, we don't know how big this phase is, so it's not 100% sure. But if you tell us a little bit about the plans.
Okay. Well, I can tell this way. Now, we have the T2K experiment, that is long baseline experiment between JPAC and Super Kamiokande. And T2K is trying to move on to the next phase, T2K2, with the higher beam power and maybe longer operation time. And they could potentially come to the, say, 3 sigma effect for the CP violation if the CP phase is just in the best angle. So clearly, this tells us that the present generation experiment is not powerful enough.
Thank you. I intentionally asked Dr. Kajito to include his talk the characteristics of this long-term research that happened in the Kamioka facility that I was able to visit. Actually, I got to be aware when I visited Japan 2 years ago. So I hope this is important for the people here, our friends, colleagues, and those who will be serving in funding agencies and giving policy, and making policy that is important that you keep funding for a long time and to really support good quality research. Thanks very much, Dr. Kajito. It's a great talk.
Thank you very much.